Yeah, so I think with that, we'll go on to the next talk. I'd like to invite Dr. S. Padmavati as a speaker, who'll be talking on neuro-ophthalmic visual field loss. She's the chief of neuro-ophthalmology services at Aravind Eye Hospital from Tirunelveli, a leader in her own strength. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Jyoti. Good evening, all. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. The topic assigned to me is neuro-ophthalmic visual field loss. Per se, visual fields, they represent the extent of the visual field which is perceived by each eye. If you see, it is almost simulated to a hill of vision. You have a high peak point which corresponds to the fovea and a small crater or a depression which corresponds to the blind spot. Any alteration or affection in the visual pathway, it alters this island of vision. It could be in the form of any craters or a depression, or it could be submerged itself. So perimetry is the art of measuring the dimensions of the visual field. So why do you do a visual field? It is for a diagnostic purpose, to diagnose a condition before you do a neuroimaging, or for follow-up of the patients. You want to monitor the disease progression, or in monitoring the day-to-day activities, how far he could cope up with the field effects. So what is the goal of perimetry? It helps you to localize as well as lateralize the lesion and also quantify the lesion. As usual, you have two types of perimetry. One is the kinetic, where you have the moving stimulus, and the static, where you have stimuli of varying intensity presented at static points. Their techniques include the confrontation, which is still holds good for bedside diagnosis in immobile patients, where you can pick up at least 75% of the neurological deficits. Still in some centers, you still have the germ screen, where in the illiterate persons, you can roughly do the field test. The Amsler testing is also another thing which measures only the central 10 degrees. The Goldman perimetry is one of the kinetic perimetry, where you have Roman numerals, where you have the numerals with the alphabets for the stimulus used. So what is this advantage? Here you have a reliable computerized static testing. This can be done with poor visual acuity. You can always detect the peripheral islands of visual field. And it is also used in the extreme periphery. Also, it helps you to evaluate the shape of the visual field effects. The main disadvantage is it is not reproducible. It is more technician dependent, and this is not universally available. The automated perimetry is a standard which is used across all the centers. This is more reproducible, objective, standardized, and sensitive, and this is less technician relevant. So the key questions when you want to interpret visual field is, first you see the reliability of the test which holds. Is the test normal or abnormal? This you can, in a neuro-ophthalmology, you can just see the grayscale to see the whether it is abnormal or normal. Whether this field effect is involves only one eye, is it monocular or it is a binocular, whether it involves both eyes. Does it respect the vertical meridian? If binocular, whether it is homonymous. Homonymous means it is either the same side or whether both the sides. If you say right side field is affected, the right temporal or the left nasal is affected, this says it is homonymous. When it is heteronymous, it is either both the temporal or by both the nasal fields. When you see a field, if you see the field effect here, the right eye, when you put the fields, you have to put the right eye in front of your right field, in front of the right eye, and the left in front of the left eye, and the right eye temporal. This is the right way of denoting the visual fields. So as such, when you see in a visual pathway, you have the nasal fibers and the temporal fibers from the nasal retina. There is crossing over of the nasal fibers, which relays in the lateral geniculate body and which continues as the optic radiation to the visual cortex. When you in the visual pathway, there is always an inverse representation. Suppose you have a field defect in the nasal side, you have a temporal field defect. When you have a superior field defect, a superior fiber affection, you have an inferior field defect. This is represented centered all way through the visual pathway. So you could classify this as a pre-chiasmal, chiasmal, and post-chiasmal. Pre-chiasmal is one which pertains to the optic nerve. I am pertaining only to the acquired lesions of the optic nerve. Before that, you have to see the arrangement of the fibers in the retina. Or the visual in the visual field, all the field defects corresponds to the fovea, not the optic disc. And you have the nasal fibers, temporal fibers, and the papillomacular bundle. So when you have a field which involves this, you have a nasal step. If you see, it is this is superior, this is inferior. So it is, as I said, you have an inverse relationship. So this, you when you have a lesion in this area, you have an inferior arcuate defect. When it involves the superior half of the optic nerve disc, you have an altitudinal field defect, which you commonly seen in ischemic optic neuropathy. The papillomacular bundle affection causes a centrosecal scotoma, whereas this, the temporal aspect, you have nasal aspect, you have a temporal wedge-shaped scotoma. So in cases of bilateral disc edema, where it is, which could be due to edema or idiopathic intracranial hypertension, you commonly have an enlarged blind spot, or you could have a peripheral constriction. This is the commonest field defect you get in idiopathic intracranial hypertension. But when you see in cases of idiopathic intracranial hypertension, you have to monitor the fields, because this could give you a prognostic value when you have to intervene surgically. Suppose you have a field defect which where you have a progression, constriction of the field, where there is progression of the visual field, that it necessitates, it indicates that the patient has a progressive visual loss. So this patient needs an immediate attention or a surgical intervention. Optic neuritis is one condition where you have a unilateral loss of vision with an RAPD. You can have a varying field defects. The commonest is a central centrosecal scotoma or an arcuate nerve fiber layer defects. So this is the article which gives you the various defects in the optic neuritis. So this was a paper which had seen in the optic neuritis treatment trial. The baseline, they had found that diffuse vision loss was the commonest finding with central and centrosecal scotoma. This is a case of unilateral loss of vision. This is this patient had a Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy where he had a centrosecal scotoma. In case of ischemic optic neuropathy, where you have a pallid disc edema with nor hyperemia on the other side, you have an altitudinal field defect corresponding to it. So here it is, visual field abnormalities in non-arteritic A1. He found that inferior nasal sectoral defect was a commonest defect when compared to a altitudinal field defect. Toxic optic neuropathy is one which we encounter in our day-to-day things. Drugs like ethambutol and also vigabatrin. The commonest field defect we encounter here is a centrosecal scotoma. And you also have a peripheral contraction of field and decrease for color objects. Moving on to the next lesions where you have a binocular field defects. This was a 43-year-old male who had a defective vision. His field absolutely in one eye was he had a hemianopia, whereas the right eye Jerome screen was absolutely normal. But the Humphrey field analyzer, automated perimetry, clinched the diagnosis where he had a field defect in the temporal superior quadrant. So this was a, you have a bitemporal hemianopia, which is irregular, which denotes it is in the lesion is in the chiasma. So this is an X-ray which shows an enlarged cella. And this was an imaging which shows a enlarged pituitary, so showing a pituitary macroadenoma. So when you the as such, this has a compression, the infranasal fibers are compressed, and the field progression is always clockwise in the right eye. In case of pituitary adenoma, the same holds opposite in case of a craniopharyngioma. So you have a infranasal fibers which are affected. So you have the densest involvement in the superior temporal quadrant. This is a fibers where you have the affection in the knee of Von Willebrand, where you have a junctional scotoma, or if you have only the isolated fibers affection, this you have a temporal hemianopia. A lesion affects cutting superiorly will involve the upper nasal fibers where you have an inferior temporal defects. A lesion involving from the pituitary will affect the lower nasal fibers, which will have a superior temporal quadrant affection first. Macular fibers have a macular hemianopic scotoma. So a lesion here will have a blindness in one eye, but when you have the angle of the eye, you have a junctional scotoma. When you have a lesion here, it is almost bitemporal hemianopia. When you have the posterior end of the chiasma which is affected, you have a bitemporal hemianopic scotoma. This you have to differentiate that from a centrosecal scotoma. This represents the vertical meridian, whereas the centrosecal scotoma doesn't respect the vertical meridian. When you have an optic tract lesion, you have a incongruous homonymous hemianopia. So this was a 15-year-old female who had a defective vision in the left eye. The fields picked out the diagnosis of almost there is a constriction of fields involvement of the total eye in the left eye, and right eye had a temporal hemianopia. So this is the case of craniopharyngioma where you have the this is the superior nasal fibers which are affected. So you have an inferior temporal. As I said, it goes clockwise, anti-clockwise in the right eye and clockwise in the left eye. So these are the different types of meningioma. One is the olfactory, one is the tuberculum cellae and the sphenoidal cellae, which causes a bitemporal hemianopia. The differential diagnosis of bitemporal hemianopia would include tilted disc, high myopia, peripapillary coloboma, any optic neuropathy with centrosecal scotoma. But mind you, all these will not respect the vertical meridian and they remain static over time. The retrochiasmal pathway, it includes the optic tract, the lateral cingulate body, optic radiation, cerebral cortex. These produce a homonymous hemianopia where one side is affected. They are usually the homonymous hemianopia is always from the lesion of the occipital lobe. Usually it is secondary to ischemia. The other clues to isolate where this lesion could be because of the optic tract or visual hallucinations in case of temporal lobe or hemisensory loss or spatial defects in case of parietal lobe. You don't have any neurological symptoms or signs when you have an occipital lobe. The commonest etiology is ischemia and the involvement is mostly occipital. The radiations account for 32% and the lateral geniculate body account for 1.3%. The study by Zhang et al., they showed that usually the teaching is the congruency increases with as you go posteriorly in the retrochiasmal lesions. Contrary to existing belief, 50% of optic tract lesions also produce congruous hemianopia instead of incongruous field defects. As I said, you have 47% uncrossed fibers with 53% crossed fibers. So if you have a left optic tract lesion, you have a right homonymous hemianopia with the RAPD on the right side and with the bout eye atrophy on the right side. So this is, you have an inequality of the pupils with large pupil on the side of hemianopia. You have a temporal pallor on the side which you have the lesion and the right eye will show a bout eye optic atrophy.
So the next, can you conclude? It's 12 minutes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, lateral geniculate body, you have a sectranopia, Mayer's loop, you have a pie in the sky, and parietal lobe lesions, you have the pie in the floor. When you have a lesion here, you have a temporal crescent, and this you have a homonymous hemianopia. With this, you have a bitemporal homonymous hemianopic scotoma. Okay, in recognizing visual field defects, you have to look at both fields together and you have to correlate with other clinical findings. Don't overlook other causes of visual field. You have to find whether it is unilateral, you think of pre-chiasmal, bilateral, it is homonymous or heteronymous, heteronymous it is chiasmal, and homonymous it is retrochiasmal. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Padmavati. That was a very intensely extensive talk. Very good. I'm sure the PGs will gain a lot from it. Dr. Jyoti, there are many questions which have been answered in our talk itself. Want to take a question or we move on?
Yeah, I think we can just, one question is what specific this program do you advise for neurological fields and any specific this threshold and what type of field do you advise?
I usually advise a 30-2 in case, because there's not much difference between a 24-2 and a 30-2, but only thing is the peripheral isopters, the temporal isopters are included here. I usually advise a 30-2. In case of any field constriction, I go for a 10-2.
Okay, right. But I think for exams, we can mention that probably we should advise a 120-2 specifically if you're looking at something to be in the periphery. Like, in those cases, we may have to apply. So depending on each condition that patient has, we can advise an appropriate field.